same for you.
Good morning. My name is Sneha and I'm a member of the congregation here at Emmanuel. A very warm welcome to you, particularly if you're joining us for the first time. Do make yourself known to one of us and we'd love to welcome you to Emmanuel. If you're joining us on the live stream or you're watching back at the service afterwards, again, a very warm welcome to you. So I just have a few notices before we get into the service. As some of you will know, if you've seen the email notices, today is Kat's ordination, and she's getting ordained at Melton Mowbray. Unfortunately, due to space constraints, not everybody is invited, but she would love to have all of us, the church family, join in for lunch this afternoon. So straight after our service here, lunch is just in the church center, and if you're free, she would love for you all to join in, so do stay back. Over the summer, most of our small groups and our discipleship groups and our communities take a break, so we don't tend to meet. But we are having some small groups meeting through the summer, and this starts on Wednesday, the 13th of July, from 7:30 to 9 p.m. in church here. So if you find yourself at a loose end, not sure what to do, or if you're not plugged into a community or a discipleship group at Emmanuel, then we'd like to invite you to come along to these summer small groups. And then lastly, after a break of 2 years, we're finally able to host a church weekend at Emmanuel. And so this is on Friday, the 9th of September to 11th, Sunday. And if you go to our website, or if you get the email notices, there should be a link there, so do get on the link, you'll find more information, and do book to come along to our church weekend. It's usually quite fun, and we have lots of yummy food, and great teaching, and a chance for us to connect to one another. So, it's that time of the service now, when we do something fun as an all-age, all-together activity. And I'm sure many of you are thinking about going away because it's the summer holidays. So you're probably thinking about what you're going to pack in your case. So I have a case here. And in this case, I'm going to put a few items. And up on the screen should come up the visuals of these items. That's on here, 6 items. Now, in a moment, I'm going to invite a few volunteers to come up. Mix of all ages. And what you will need to do, it's very simple. You will need to choose some of these items, not all, but some of these items to pack into your case to go away. So there are 6 there. I won't tell you just yet how many you can take, but this is to give you an idea of what you are to do. So can I have some volunteers? Maybe 3 or 4 people? And if you are very, very little, do come on with your parent. Yes? I need to get my timer. Yes, thank you very much for volunteering. Do come on. 2 more. Come on, Lizzie. I saw that arm go up a little bit. 1 more person. Come on then, Elijah. Okay, so you'll need to work as a team. And if you hold on to these, or you can pass it amongst you, I'm going to give you... It's not going to be very long, I'm afraid. You will have 20 seconds to decide Five of these items need to make it into the case. Which five are you going to choose? Okay, your time starts now. So only five. We really need some music here, don't we? Countdown timer. Now you can have a think about this. If it was you, what would you choose? That's it. Your timer is finished. So I didn't explain these. If you can't see at the back, it's money, there's some clothes or shoes or accessories, it's a water bottle, cuddly toy, or very important cuddly toy, phone and phone charger. So, team, which five items have you decided need to go in the case? You've got the five items. Okay, let's have a look. So, cuddly toy goes into the case, can't do without a cuddly toy. Phone charger, extremely important, I'm with you on that. And phone, of course. Money, yep, very much needed. And clothes, good choice. Now then, it's a week before departure, and you get a message saying, oh, actually, there's no space for five items. You've got to reduce the weight of your bags. It can only be three items. So, here you go again. The timer will start shortly. Which three items are you going to take? And which three items might you take? Excellent, 3 seconds to go. Brilliant, and let's see what three items you've chosen, okay? So we've got clothes, you're taking clothes. Got money, yeah, that's quite sensible. You can buy most things if you've got some money, so that's fine. Cuddly toy, I'm with you on this one. Cuddly toy trumps over everything else. Excellent, now, few days to go, and you're told, oh, actually, you've got to reduce the weight of your bags even more. Only one item can make it. Which one item? You've got 10 seconds this time, just 10 seconds, go. And which one item might you take? Ah, excellent. You've already chosen your item, money. Money, I wonder if that's what you might take too. This is quite a sensible choice. Well, thank you very much. Let's give them a big round of applause. And do take a seat. Thank you. Well done. Now, for those of us who are staying back at the service, we will be looking at a passage later on where Jesus tells his disciples to go away to the towns and villages to talk about him, to tell the people about him. And he says, take nothing with you. No bag, no extra pair of sandals, nothing. And I just wonder, what would we do if we were in that position? I take a lot of things when I go away, and that's quite challenging, isn't it? But Ruth will bring more to us, more insight into traveling lightly. So we stand now to just say these opening words together. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we're going to just have a moment of worship, but before we sing, let me just pray for our children and young people who are going to go out in the second song. Father, we just thank you for our children and young people in our church, and we just pray for your blessing over them and over their teachers and volunteers as they faithfully bring your word to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you, we turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new, you make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Because when we see you, because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Sing that again, because when we see you, because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come have your way, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. He brought me in, oh, his love for me, oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son's sets free. All is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child.
So we'll just go into a time of confession now. And I'd like to just invite you to pause and look back on your week. And is there anything that we need to bring to our Lord to say sorry for? As we go through the words on the screen, do join in with the words in bold. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world, and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have not loved you with all our heart, nor our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. Amen. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Savior, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll now have our prayers.
Dear Lord, as we come to you now, I pray that we forget about all that's happened this week and we fix our eyes on you. I pray that anything that distracts us, I pray that we look to you and that we take our minds off those things and are distracted by your love. I thank you so much for this relationship we can have with you, Lord, that you sent your Son to die on the cross to remove the barrier between us and you. I pray that we're motivated by that to seek you and to see more of you. And as a church, I pray that we seek you in the scriptures and in prayer. I pray that this transforms us and it bears fruit. And I pray that the desire to seek you is what drives this church. And I pray that we try and cultivate this desire to seek more of you. And I pray that this transforms us into the image of your Son. I pray for the church. I pray for the church weekend that we're having. I pray that we have really strong teaching and fellowship. And I pray that we're built up in our faith because of it. I thank you so much for what the church does to build up believers here. And I pray that this is another example of the church building us up in wisdom and truth. I pray for the community we have here. I thank you so much for the gift of fellowship that you purchased for us on the cross. I thank you that we can have older members of the church shepherding the younger members, and I pray for that we learn wisdom from those that are older than us in the congregation. I pray for the younger members of the congregation. I pray that we have the enthusiasm and passion to serve you. I pray for the children and the youth work. I pray that they're being built up in wisdom and truth. I pray that I pray for the volunteers. I pray that your hand is over them, and I pray that these children stand in your grace, Lord. I thank you so much for home groups. I thank you so much for the big impact those small groups can have. I pray that that's a real time to grow in the knowledge of you through the word and time to spend in prayer together. I thank you so much for these groups and how they are building up believers and keeping us focused on you, Lord. I thank you for the STB plant. I thank you for the growth that they've been seeing. I pray that your hand is continually over them, and I pray that they stand in your grace. I pray that you continue to build up their church, and I pray that you build up believers there. I pray that they are a positive influence on the community, and that you lead people to know you through the work that STB do. I pray for those in Loughborough, Lord. I pray that for those that don't know you, I pray that you your spirit is over them, and I pray that you draw people to you through the work that Emmanuel do. I pray that people see the fruit that is being bared through the church, and I pray that you draw people to come to know you as a result of that. I pray for the local authorities. I thank you so much that you put in local authorities to govern, and I pray that we're able to submit to them. I pray that they are doing your will, and I pray that your will is done through the local authorities in Loughborough. I pray for those that are suffering in Loughborough and those that are mourning. I pray that your peace is over them, and that you use the tough times that people are having to draw people closer to you and to show people something of who you are. I pray for Christians that are being persecuted around the world. I pray that you give them strength during tough times. I pray that they see your light in darkness. I pray that you build up people from places like the UK to want to help and serve these people. I pray that you give us the heart to help those that are being persecuted around the world, Lord. I pray that you continue to move in these countries that Christians are being persecuted, and I pray that you continue to have them grow and have people come to know you more through the work that these persecuted Christians are doing. I thank you so much that people from these countries come to the UK, Lord. I thank you so much that they have the chance to hear the gospel when they're here. I thank you so much that the church works with Friends International, and I pray that you continue to work through for the collaboration that they have on Fridays here. I pray that people from unreached people groups are saved through the work that Emmanuel are doing with Friends International. I thank you so much for the movements in the Arab world. I thank you that people are coming to faith at exceeding rates, Lord. I pray that you continue to continue this, and I pray that we continue to see this revival, even though they're being persecuted. I pray that your hand is continually over them, and we see more and more people come to faith. I pray that you lead churches in the UK to do all we can to support them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Before Ruth comes to preach us, we're going to sing again, so may I invite you to stand.
Name it is,
What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Amen. Do please take your seats and we'll have our reading.
Reading from Luke. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If the head of a house loves peace, your peace will rest on that house. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for workers deserve their wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and you are welcomed, eat what is set before you. Heal those there who are ill and tell them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near.'" This is the word of the Lord.
Three women. Okay. I'm not saying anything. Thank you. Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you for your written word. We thank you for your living word. We ask for your presence with us here today, that you will speak to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, we had Meet Jesus, and then we had Follow Jesus, and now we have Share Jesus. And this time we find Jesus sending out 72, as it says in our translation, 72 others. Now, we know something about the variety of the personalities that were among Jesus' closest followers, his disciples, his apostles. We know that there was a fisherman, there was a government employee, that was Matthew, the tax collector, there was a government hater, Simon the Zealot, as well as two lots of brothers in that group of 12. And now we come to a much bigger group being sent out. I don't know what size your group of friends are or how many people maybe you work with, but if you've ever been part of a large group or a group of people you know, lots of people have been on holiday, you'll know that 70 people come in all sorts of shapes, sizes and temperaments. And we're normally about 100 people for this service. I mean, you only have to look around and you'll know that there's a variety of people here this morning, a variety of shapes, a variety of sizes, and a variety of temperaments. These were people like us, and we read that Jesus appointed them and sent them out in pairs. Well, I wonder how that went. Two people meeting each other socially, may be okay. Two people working together may be absolutely fine. But two people traveling and living and trying to share good news together, that might not be quite so easy. It's not easy when you're together 24/7. To further complicate things in this scenario, they were told to limit what they took with them. No purse, no bag, no sandals. Now, that would have presented a problem for some, but maybe not for others. I have a friend who shall remain nameless because she may come here one day and worship with me. But she likes going on cruises. And the reason she likes going on cruises is that she can pack as much as she likes. She doesn't have to worry about weight. And she can put everything in the boot of the car. And when they get down to Southampton, someone will come and take the luggage out of the boot and put it in the cabin. And then she doesn't have to think, have I forgotten something important? Or I wish I brought this outfit and not that outfit. And so it goes on. Her husband is the direct opposite. One pair of shorts, a couple of pairs of trousers, a couple of shirts, a pair of shoes, change of underwear if you're lucky, and he's set to go. He's ready. He's ready for the off. Well, this group of 70 people would have come from different working and home backgrounds, and they were sent out in pairs to work and live together. And no mention is made of taking a change of underwear. They were sent out ahead of Jesus so that they could prepare the way for his coming. How would you do that? What would that look like for you with your friends and neighbors, your colleagues? How could you, or do you, prepare the way for Jesus to come in? Now, these people, this group of people, would have known about John the Baptist, that voice in the wilderness who declared that he was sent to prepare the way of the Lord. And they would have heard about the way in which he meant, by which he met his end, by having his head taken off. And now these 70, 72 in this version, were being appointed, invited to step up to make public what they had seen and heard. They were being asked to prepare the way of the Lord. This is God's people being asked to leave behind all they would normally rely on for daily life. The laptop, the mobile phone, the fridge, the TV, the comfortable sofa, the home-cooked food. And go out and talk to people face to face. They were sent to people who were local to them. They weren't being sent overseas. They were sent to the places they could walk to. And they were told to stay in those locations. Now, traveling together is one thing. Doing something new with someone you don't know and staying in the homes of people you've never met, that would be very challenging. I worked for Salt Mine Trust for a while, a theatre company, and they had a band and different things, and they're on the road a lot. And whenever the young people who formed the theatre company or band were on the road, hospitality with local hosts was provided for them. And they were expected to share rooms, and after a long day of loading and unloading vans, acting in schools or theatre, or leading worship in churches or at conferences, they were expected to go back to their host families and be pleasant, be civil and respectful, not just go to bed. Now, these were Christian families, so there would already have been some common ground. But at the end of a day, when all you want to do is just go home and crash, it's not easy to find yourself having to make conversation and be nice. And maybe for them, in a different home night after night for a week or so. I can tell you it made for some interesting conversations on their return to the office. One of those conversations went something like this. If you put something on social media, you put something about your host on social media, it's quite possible your host will see what you have put on social media. So it might be wiser not to post anything at all. Just talk to us about it when you come back. Jesus wasn't sending this group of people abroad. He was challenging them to live out their faith where they lived and moved and had their being, to prepare the way for Jesus to come after. Loughborough, Leicester, Nottingham, on the internet with the neighbours, at work, in the pub, at the club, at school, at college. He didn't expect them to be walked over, though. He didn't want them to be trampled underfoot. They were to be bringers of peace, and peace isn't always what people are looking for. And so these people were free to walk away, to shake the dust off their feet. And whether welcome or not, the kingdom of God would have come near, and people's lives would have been touched. Many of you will know Richard Coles, either from his time on Strictly Come Dancing or through his Radio 4 programme on a Saturday morning. He recently retired from parish ministry, and without wanting to promote a book he's written called Murder Before Evensong, he compares life as a parish priest to that of a detective when he says, "I think anyone who's been in parish ministry will find the life of the parish priest in some ways maps on to that of a detective, because you're kind of looking at the exterior of things and for disruptions in the pattern and wondering what that might tell you about what is going on underneath." And it's not just parish priests who do that sort of thing, but something all of us who are Christians can do as we connect with people around us. What is God saying in their lives? What is going on for them? What was underneath what they said? What caused them to respond in that way? Was it something I said? Or was it the Spirit of God at work? Turning those thoughts into prayer for the people we've met, who may have spurned us, offended us, or they may have received us with open arms. As we turn to God in prayer, willing to be open ourselves and to learn where we might have got things wrong or done something differently, thinking about where we feel that person or those people may be struggling and inviting the Holy Spirit into our lives and our dealings with them, all of that can change both them and us. We're not the ones in charge. God is the one in charge. We relinquish control. We are simply preparers of the way. And sometimes, very often, God's work takes a lot longer than we might think appropriate. We may never see the outcome, but the connection with God has the potential of changing people and situations because the kingdom of God has come near. So the message seems to be, are we available for the Lord of the harvest to send us out? Do we want to be involved in preparing the way of the Lord? If so, don't expect to have all you think you might need for what you perceive to be the journey ahead of you. Travel lightly. Don't worry about what you're wearing, what you have with you. Be who you are, who God has called you to be. Accept the hospitality of others, enter their homes if you're invited. Be a part of their lives, eat with them, provided you don't have allergies. Share with them. And don't worry if that doesn't work out as you might have hoped. We are just preparers of the way. Jesus will follow. Our reading doesn't go as far as the return of this large group of people, where Jesus greets them with great joy, and where in verses 21 and 22, he rejoices in the Holy Spirit over all that has been achieved, saying, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent, but have revealed them to infants." Jesus rejoiced in the fact that the people he had sent out were so varied and so different that they didn't know everything. They hadn't had any special training, but they were called, and God had been with them in the challenges they had faced so that they came back rejoicing. Well, I wonder what you're doing over the next few weeks of summer. Where you'll be going, who you'll meet, what you'll pack. And will you pray to the Lord of the harvest before you go? as you also prepare the way for him to come after you. Who knows what the autumn at Emmanuel could look like if we are prepared to make ourselves available to God over the summer months. Amen.
Thank you, Ruth. That's exactly what I needed to hear this morning. We're now going to stand to have for a time of worship, and the offertory will be taken in the second song.
Shall we stand?
You alone can rescue, you alone can save.
Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
And as we stay standing, let's just say this closing prayer together. Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son Jesus Christ has sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us in this mission and help us to live the good news we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us this morning, and we look forward to seeing you next week.